Good evening. Melbourne's aged care emergency has claimed seven more lives as Victoria's COVID death toll soared to 56. 300 new cases emerged, with the army enlisted to doorknock people who test positive in a crackdown on contact tracing. Senior police have blasted selfish and childish conspiracy theorists who've refused to cooperate at checkpoints, and relief for expectant parents following a backflip on hospital visits. Andrew Lund has the latest.
Maria Vassilakis and Helen Alexiou were both much-loved grandmothers, but their families are now among seven left grieving after Victoria's deadliest day of the COVID-19 pandemic.
This will be a particularly challenging and difficult time, a very sad time for them.
Today's grim toll includes two men and two women aged in their 80s and two men and one woman aged in their 90s. Five were residents of aged care homes. The state's death toll now stands at 56.
I have always expressed concern about the fact that whenever you have hundreds of new cases a day, that there will be several people who are expected to die in the following two-week period. I'm afraid we will see that. I expect that to occur.
Victoria today recorded 300 new cases of coronavirus, a lower figure than in recent days. And with 20 cases reclassified, the net rise of 280 takes the total to 7,405.
While there is some better news today out of Victoria, that is not something we can assume will continue, and so we must maintain the full force of effort.
There are currently 3,734 active cases, with 206 Victorians in hospital, 41 in intensive care.
Some of those people who are in intensive care and on ventilators are younger individuals.
Not even 6 months old, Stevie is among the youngest Victorians to test positive. She's recovering after a two-night emergency stay in Casey Hospital.
She wasn't drinking her bottles and she just generally wasn't herself. And then that night she, again, was having trouble breathing, and she was, in a bit of distress.
The growing caseload is taking a toll on health workers.
We are struggling. Our staff are tired. We're very well supported and we're ready to keep going, but we need the team to come together.
So police have little patience with conspiracy theorists and others looking for loopholes at checkpoints.
It's not one of your human rights to endanger other people. It's not one of your human rights to put other people at risk.
1,400 defence personnel are now on the ground in Victoria. Dozens will be tasked to assist with contact tracing.
If contact cannot be made with them via those two telephone calls in a two-hour period, then ADF and authorised officers will be deployed to go and door knock those people.
If they don't come for testing, we'll drive a truck at the end of the street and we'll test them there.
57 cases have been linked to Bitoki Small Goods in Thomastown. Six others have been connected to the Malmesbury Youth Justice Centre. And having recorded more than 2,200 new cases in the past week, the Australian Medical Association has renewed its call for even tougher restrictions.
A move to further restrictions would send a powerful message to all Victorians that this is a very serious situation.
But the Chief Health Officer appears confident current measures will suffice.
Masks are our stage four, in a way.
Is it the most pleasant experience? No, but it's making a big difference in slowing the spread of this virus.
Let's go live now to Andrew at Treasury Place. Andrew, what came of today's National Cabinet meeting?
Well, Pete, leaders were briefed on the situation here, which is still causing huge concern around the country. South Australia has announced even tighter restrictions on its border with Victoria. Effective from Tuesday night, nobody, including South Australians, will be able to cross back into South Australia except for essential travellers. National leaders have agreed to pursue a virus suppression strategy with a goal of zero community transmission. So not quite elimination, but clearly Victoria still has a very long way to go, Pete.
Andrew Lund reporting. Well, the ADF has started knocking on doors to tell people they've tested positive for COVID-19 if they're refusing to answer their phones. Mark Santomartino's in Maribyrnong. Mark, anyone who isn't home will be fined.
Everyone who gets tested, Pete, is supposed to be in isolation until they receive their results. So if the ADF do come knocking and you're not at home, you can expect to be slapped with that $1,600 fine. Here's how the system now works. On the day you test positive, expect a call from the health department, typically from an anonymous phone number. If you fail to answer that call, they'll try again within about 2 hours. But if you don't pick up again or refuse an interview, the ADF will be deployed to your doorstep. It's all in a bid to speed up the contact tracing system here in the state. There are roughly 2,500 cases which are still under investigation here in Victoria. The ADF has been called in to help with the goal of getting on top of that as soon as possible. Those initial interviews are supposed to be done within 24 hours in order to get on top of outbreaks before they start.
That's not something to be afraid of. That's just everyone working together as one team to make sure that we've got the best public health response to this global pandemic.
Beyond patrolling the CBD, 28 ADF strike teams are being deployed to the suburbs, charged with tracking down the 1 in 4 patients who don't answer their phones to find out they're COVID positive.
Chasing down every single case every day and making sure they are isolated. That is how we're going to get on top of this.
This is about going that extra step to make sure that we can not just call, but we can connect and have that meaningful interaction, get that interview done.
65 cases have been door-knocked in the past 2 days, with 53% of Victorians refusing to isolate after getting a test. Anyone found not to be at home will be fined.
You'll have some very clear explaining to do as to why you are not at home, isolated, as you should be, because you have tested positive.
There are challenges in parts of Melbourne, and that's why we genuinely seek everybody's cooperation.
That cooperation is hoped to fix the current lag in the state's contact tracing team, which took 4 days to reach out to barber Jack Zhao after one of his employees tested positive.
That is how we will get to the other side of this quicker. That is how you will avoid a fine. That is how you will protect the vulnerable, indeed every member of every family, because this is not just a disease of the frail.
Mark Santomartino, Nine News.